السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. My dear brothers and sisters, I welcome you back to our journey of the biography of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with the authentic hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Tonight is the night of the 8th of Jumada Thani, 1443 years after the Hijrah, or the migration of our beloved Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, which coincides with November 13, 2021. Today we are going to talk about a specific aspect of the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ which we are discussing, which is the amrul jahiliyyah, the matters of the pre-Islamic period, which continues to be affecting all of the stages of the ummah until the day of judgment. Unless we know these diseases and we solve it with the sunnah, we will not be able to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the reasons we study the biography of the Prophet ﷺ is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him as an example for us for all of the stages of our life. So today we are going to see at a stage where we leave the world, ourselves or our beloved family members or friends or neighbors or whoever from the Muslims who leave, one of the aspects that we have to follow that protocol so that we are protected from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and specifically those who have left us, to protect them from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This study of this section of the seerah will teach us that, which is lamenting for the dead. Crying, wailing, not crying meaning like weeping, but wailing and other things people do when they lose their close family members. We have mentioned this hadith before, but we are going to read the full today. This hadith is reported by Imam Muslim on the authority of Abu Malik al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, that the Messenger said, أَرْبَعٌ مِنْ أُمَّتِي مِنْ أَمْرِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ لَا يَتُرُكُونَهُنَّ الْفَخْرَ فِي الْأَحْسَابِ وَالطَّعْنُ فِي الْأَنْسَابِ وَالْإِسْتِسْقَاءُ بِالنُّجُومِ وَالنِّيَاحَ. Four of the matters, of the matters of Jahiliyyah, pre-Islamic period, which my Ummah will not abandon. One of them is boasting about the high rank, the lineage or the high rank, reviling other people's lineage or genealogy, seeking the rain through the star, and we have spoken about these things in our previous episodes of the seerah, and the wailing, a niyaha, and this is exactly what we are going to talk about today. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَقَالَ النِّيَاحَةُ إِذَا لَمْ تَتُبْ قَبْلَ مَوْتِهَا تُقَامُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَعَلَيْهَا سِرْبَالٌ مِنْ قِطْرَانٍ وَدِرْعٌ مِنْ جَرَبٍ. And if the wailing woman who does not repent before she dies, this is the one who wailed or lamented, she will be made to stand on the day of resurrection wearing a garment of pitch and a dress of jarab is a type of a disease that the camel has, a type of disease. That kind of dress this woman will be wearing. And of course this punishment will be also for a male lamenter too. This lamenting about the lamenting, we have also other hadith reported by Imam al-Bukhari on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu and Ibn Abbas. We have mentioned this before, but we want to be short in this class inshallah, and we cannot bring all of the narration of course. Today the narrations that we're going to discuss, the summary of that is the Prophet ﷺ freed himself from anybody who wails, laments, tears the clothes, slaps the cheek, and so on and so forth. He took a pledge from the women when they used to come and give the pledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to take a pledge from the women not to associate partners with Allah, not to commit adultery, not to kill their children, and niyaha or wailing was part of it. They were made to make an oath while they were entering Islam that they are not going to lament. They are not going to wail, especially the women, because they are more like vulnerable to this kind of activities. But does it not include the men? For sure it does. For sure it does. We also learn that lamenting is kufr, and it is from the matters of al-jahiliyyah. We will learn that lamenting will harm the dead person. How? He will be punished for that. In general, in one narration, another narration the Prophet mentioned he will be punished in the grave. And another narration, he clarified that the dead person will be punished for lamenting even on the day of judgment. And of course you have heard that the lamenter himself or herself will be punished by wearing a certain kind of very disgusting dress on the day of judgment. So all of these are severe warning for something that people take for granted because at that time they are vulnerable. And they think that by screaming and shouting and yelling, they are doing a favor upon themselves and also favor upon the dead. Because in some culture, the more you lament, the more you are going to make people realize how great this person was or how we greatly miss him or her. This is something that is very common. I'm talking about in many Muslim culture, unfortunately. And that is something we need to warn against because of these severe narrations. Hadith in Bukhari, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس منا من ضرب الخدود. He is not from amongst us, a person, he is not from amongst us, the one who slaps his cheeks, وشق الجيوب, and he tears his clothes, ودعا بدعوة الجاهلية, and revives or follows the tradition of the people of the pre-Islamic period. And the narration which is reported by Abdullah ibn Umar, that the Prophet said, الميت يعذب في قبره بمنياح عليه. A dead person will be punished, and this is in Bukhari, a dead person will be punished in the grave for being lamented for. And the narration, الميت يعذب, this is general, will be punished ببكاء الحي عليه. He will be punished because of the wailing of the living persons. Wailing of the living persons. Another narration, Mughira ibn Shu'bah radiallahu anhu, سَمِعْتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ سَلَّمَ يَقُولْ مَنْ نِيَاحَ عَلَيْهِ يُعَذِّبُ بِمَنْ نِيَاحَ عَلَيْهِ. The one who will be lamented for, he will be punished because of this lamenting. The dead person will be punished because of this lamenting. Bukhari also reported an incident on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. The Prophet ﷺ went to visit a sahabi called Sa'ad ibn Ubadah, and he was very sick. So when the Prophet ﷺ went there, he saw that people gathered around Sa'ad ibn Ubadah. So he asked, did he pass away, meaning did he die? They said, no, Prophet of Allah. So the Prophet ﷺ started weeping, buka, he weeping. So when the people saw him weeping, they also started weeping. So then the Prophet ﷺ, you see, these are the lesson we learn. In those very vulnerable situation, they used to teach. The Prophet ﷺ used to teach. Nowadays, if you tell them, brother, this is not the sunnah. Oh, even now you come and you show us your extremism. No, it is not extremism. Teaching the sunnah is the right way. So the Prophet ﷺ said, أَلَا تَسْمَعُونَ, don't you hear? إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُعَذِّبُ بِدَمِ الْعَيْنِ. Allah will not punish because of the tears of the eyes. وَلَا بِحُزْنِ الْقَلْبِ, and not because of the sadness of the heart. Because this is what is natural, okay? وَلَكِنِ يَعَذِّبُ بِهَذَا وَأَشَارَ إِلَى لِسَانِهِ, and he pointed to his finger, to his tongue, and he mentioned that, but Allah will punish because of this, okay? أَوْ يَرْحَمُ, or he will have mercy. وَإِنَّ الْمَيَّتِ يُعَذِّبُ بِبُكَاءِ أَهْلِهِ, indeed, the dead person is punished because of the بُكَاءِ أَهْلِهِ, because of some of the weeping of his family. And what this means is, not all sorts of weeping, because it's also clarified. This tear and the sadness of the heart is also part of weeping. This weeping will not harm the dead person. So which weeping? The weeping which has the wailing. Tearing clothes, lamenting, oh, this man was such great, oh, we miss him, and start screaming. Everybody start another round of screaming and crying and all these things. And the narration says, the hadith is hazir, وَكَانَ عُمَرُ, Abdullah ibn Umar saying, about his father, وَكَانَ عُمَرَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ يَدْرِبُ فِيهِ بِالْعَصَى, he would hit them with his stick, وَيَرْمِ بِالْحِجَارَ, or he would throw stones at them, وَيَحْثِي بِالْتُرَابِ, or would put dust in the mouth for those people who are wailing. because he was the Amir al-Mu'mineen and he took this very, very seriously. Because we have to understand that the one who died, he needs our help. And we are not helping them if we don't follow the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Especially, we are reinventing or reintroducing the Amrul Jahiliyyah. And when we reintroduce this, our children and the environment learns from us and they're going to keep copy-pasting it. I saw so-and-so doing it, it must be good. They are Muslims, they did it, it must be good, and they will copy-paste it. And it will be a source of sadness for all of us on the Day of Judgment unless we repent from it, inshallah. Another hadith in Sahih Muslim, very beautiful. This has happened to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, the great Sahabi Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu. It is when he was about to die, he lost his consciousness. So he heard some of the women, maybe his wife or somebody, and one of the narration clarifies version that it was his wife. They screamed, yelled, wailing. And he could not, at that point, he could not warn them. Why? Because he fainted. When he came back to senses, and this is how they died, as you can see. While in their deathbed, Allah gave them thabat, steadfastness to present the truth. Okay? So when he came back to his senses, what did he say? He said, "Ana bari'u mimma bari'a minhu Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." I am free from the one who the Prophet, Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, freed himself from. فَإِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بَرِئَ مِنَ الصَّالِقَةِ وَالْحَالِقَةِ وَالشَّاقَّةِ. Because indeed the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam freed himself from the one who wails, a woman who wails, a woman who shaves her hair, حَالِقَة, shaves her hair, وَالشَّاقَة, and the one who tears her clothes. Another narration, the Messenger, he said that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَنَا بَرِئُ مِمَّا حَلَقَ وَسَلَقَ wa kharaqa, the one who shaves and the one who wails and the one who tears. And this is something Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, as these are reported in the Sahih, he mentioned this to his family members while in his deathbed. And we are sometimes alive and healthy, our family are alive and healthy, and we do not warn them and we do not advise them. Because we are affected by, oh, what they are going to think. Oh, I don't want to hurt their feelings. This is not how we present the Islam to our children, our family members. Imam Muslim also reported on the authority of Ali ibn Rabi'ah that the first person who was lamented upon in Kufa was Qarada ibn Ka'ab radiallahu anhu. And when he was done that, Mughir ibn Shu'bah, the Sahabi, he stood up and he said, "Man niyaha alayhi fa'innahu yu'adhibu bima niyaha alayhi yawm al-qiyamati." The one who is lamented for would be punished because of the lamentation on the Day of Judgment. Now this is talking about the person for whom the lamenting was done. The person for whom the lamenting was done. Another narration, this is a very beautiful narration on the authority of her mother Aisha radiallahu anha. And this happened after the Battle of the Mu'ta, where three of the great Sahabi, they were, they reached their martyrdom, which is Zayd ibn al-Haritha, Jafar ibn Abi Talib, and Abdullah ibn Rawaha radiallahu anhu. When this news came, the Prophet ﷺ, our mother Aisha reported, and this hadith in Muslim, he was very, very sad. And she said, "I saw from the crack of the door that the Prophet was sitting, and somebody came and said that the women in the household of Jafar is lamenting." The narration says buka. So the Prophet sent them to tell them not to do that. Of course, they were not just weeping, they were adding maybe certain prohibited things. So the man went, and then he again came back, and he said the same thing. So the Prophet told them to stop, and she said, probably he also said, put dust in their mouth. So the man went, and of course he didn't do that. So our mother Aisha, she was angry. She said, may your nose be rubbed on the dust. You did not follow the Prophet's command, neither did you leave him from your bickering. I.e. they kept on complaining, but when the Prophet gave them the solution, they could not do it. They didn't apply it. And that's what our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, she meant. Also, Imam Muslim reports the hadith of Umm Atiyyah radiallahu anha. Umm Atiyyah radiallahu anha, she mentioned that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took bay'ah, pledge from the women, that they should not lament. And this group of women, when they gave this pledge to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this specific group she is talking about, not all the women, the specific group, she witnessed. She said none of them could fulfill that promise except five. One of them is Umm Sulaim, and this is the mother of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. The other one is herself, Umm Atiyyah. Umm Sulaim, Umm Ala, another Sahabi called Umm Ala. وابنتا أبي سبرة وامرأة معاذ and the daughter of Abu Sabra and the wife of Mu'adh أو ابنتا أبي سبرة وامرأة معاذ or it could be the daughter of Abu Sabra and the wife of Mu'adh. These five women are the only ones from that specific group that Umm Atiyyah she witnessed are the only ones could protect themselves from lamenting, and that shows that this is something very difficult, especially for the women to control. So that's something that we should ask Allah to save us from. Like for example, some people they say, oh, what happened? Instead of saying, Alhamdulillah, inna lillahi wa inna ilahi rajiun, Allah ma'jurni fi musibati wa akhlufni khayra min. How did this happen? Why Allah did this to us? This is so bad. This is what's part of the lamenting, and this is even kufr, because this is questioning Allah's decision. This is questioning Allah's decision. Death and life is the decision of Allah. So if you have a problem with a death, like the way we have problem with birth, some people, as you know that, they think that more than two children is not allowed. Because this is the Western philosophy. Okay? And this is something not allowed to be propagated like that. So when they hear that somebody is having more children, they get frustrated, they get angry. So the same way we should not have problem with birth is the same way we should not have problem with death. Of course, it's going to hurt us and our feelings when somebody dies, but we should not lose our mind and say things for which the dead person will be punished and also we will be punished on the Day of Judgment. Umm Atiyyah, she said that when the Prophet ﷺ, when the verse was revealed about the bay'ah for the women, in Surah Al-Mumtahina, verse number 12, Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu idha ja'aka al-mu'minat, oh, the Prophet, when the believing women come to you. And this is talking about the bay'ah, how the Prophet is supposed to take the bay'ah, the pledge from the believing women when they come to enter Islam and to pledge to him. She said that part of this pledge was the niyaha, that they are not supposed to wail. Okay? As she mentioned in the other narration. So when this was mentioned, the Prophet mentioned, she said that, O Prophet of Allah, in the time of Al-Jahiliyyah, there are one tribe, they helped me to wail, and I have a pact with them that I have to also wail for them. So the Prophet ﷺ said, and I have no other way out because I promised them. So the Prophet ﷺ told her, only one exception. It is for you and especially for that tribe. And this is of course approved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was exception for Umm Atiyyah radiallahu ta'ala anha. Other than that, it was not given to anybody else. There are narrations which says some other sahabiyat was given also this exemption for a specific case, but those narrations are not authentic. The only authentic narration we have is the narration of Umm Atiyyah Ridwanullahi Al-Jumain, As-Sahabat Al-Kiram. There is a lot of discussion with regards to the wailing and weeping and different narrations. I'm going to summarize it because we don't have too much time, and this is not exactly a class to talk about the rulings of the funeral, but of course this is part of the seerah and we are discussing from that angle. So we are going to now, inshallah, summarize what is the difference between weeping and wailing, weeping versus wailing. First of all, no sahaba differed that weeping is allowed. Weeping is not allowed. Of course, weeping is allowed. Weeping meaning tears, shedding tears, being sad, crying, in the sense that no lamenting is there, this is allowed. No sahaba they differed on this. No sahaba differed that lamenting is haram. Tearing clothes is haram. Slapping the cheeks is haram. All of these were forbidden. And they understood this equally, that this is wrong. However, there are some differences that happen with regards to what kind of wailing will harm the dead person or not. Okay? So from the Sahabatul Kiram radiallahu anhum, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu especially, and some of them they said also Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, but for sure, specifically Ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar used to believe that all sorts of wailing will punish the dead person. All sorts of wailing. Whereas his father Umar radiallahu anhu used to distinguish some type of wailing. Which type of wailing? The ulama, they differed. Okay, so many aqwal, this. We are going to talk about the most authentic and the most balanced opinion, inshallah ta'ala. But before that, let's talk about the Sahabat al-Kiram radhiyallahu anhum. From the Sahabat al-Kiram, as I mentioned, that Ibn Umar used to generalize it. You wail, the dead person will be punished. That's it. This was his position. Our mother Aisha had a different position. She used to, and her position is not all really very, I would say, like very, very clear. But when they came and they said about Abdullah ibn Umar's position, she said, no. In some narration, these are all in Sahih Muslim, all I'm talking about from all authentic reports. Okay? No, none of these I'm using some other narrations, which has some questions. All authentic narration. She mentioned, she explained, she said that they heard a part of the narration and they didn't hear another part. In some cases, she mentioned that Ibn Umar misunderstood what the Prophet meant. In another narration, she said that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned about the wailing which will harm the dead person. This is only for the non-Muslims. And specifically, she mentioned a Jewish woman was wailed for and the Prophet ﷺ said it. So it looks like she used to refer this wailing and punishing. Of course, she used to know that wailing is haram. But will the dead person be punished because of the wailing of the living? She had an interpretation, most likely. She used to believe that no. If he is a Muslim or she is a Muslim, no, because this hadith applies to the Jewish woman or any of the non-Muslims. And she also used to mention the hadith, the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةً وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. No soul will carry the burden of another soul. Okay? So, her position was, how can the dead Muslim be punished for the action of the live person? That's what looks like to be from all of her explanation. This was his position. This was her position. What is the overall correct position from the Sunnati Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? From the Sunnati Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and after we see all of these discussions from the Sahabat al-Kiram and the ulama of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, what is being summarized by Imam Ibn Hajar and others, great scholars like Imam Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, rahmatullahi alayh, they said that weeping is allowed as long as there is no lamenting, praising or boasting. Okay? Which means no use of the tongue. So, either with good speech or bad speech. For example, when a dead person is praised and he is praised for things which he didn't do it for the sake of Allah. For example, he was a leader and he is praised for his leadership, but his leadership was not for the sake of Allah. Or he did something, bir, goodness, and his goodness was not for the sake of Allah. Or his bravery, for which he is praised, but his bravery was not applied for the ta'atillah, obedience of Allah, in the path of Allah. For this scenario, he will be punished. Similarly, if somebody is being accused. That's why when we talk about our dead relatives, we have to be very careful. Oh, they did this, or they did that, or they did this, or they did that. They're going to be punished for these things because we are using the tongue and we are remembering all of these things of their past. This is something very, very dangerous. We should not do that. The dead person will not be, and then they clarified that the dead person will not be punished if this weeping is not from their tradition. You are from a family, you know that lamenting is haram. And you believe that, you follow that, you taught that for the sake of Allah. When you die, somebody comes and laments. The ulama is saying, this type of lamenting, the dead person will not be punished. Okay? And he did not advise them to do it. Because some people, they even advise, you should lament for us. Because, you know, it will make us look good. It will draw a lot of attention. As long as he didn't advise, and he warned against it. How? By following the sunnah of Prophet ﷺ. Not because, oh, I don't like wailing, don't do that. No. I do not like wailing because this is forbidden in Islam. I don't like wailing because the Prophet ﷺ forbade this. Because the dead person will be punished in the grave, in general, on the Day of Judgment, and this and that. And this is from the matter of Al-Jahiliyyah. And he has freed himself in his lifetime from such scenario, then this type of people will not be punished because of the wailing of Al-Hayy. And that's why when the Prophet bibukai, the ulama said, when they said, the Prophet said, bibukai ahlihi, the ba here is ba'diyya, certain types of wailing, not all types of wailing. Certain types of wailing, and that's this position, what looks to be, is the most correct and the most balanced of all of the other positions. So what do we have to do? We have to learn the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And we have to teach that. Once we teach that, and we follow that in the tradition. If we teach and somebody dies, we wail. And we teach the same thing and we wail, which means what? We are just parroting it. We are not following the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. So now the tradition is what? Is the tradition of Amrul Jahiliyyah. So although we have mentioned the hadith to the people, but we did not follow up with our action, when we are in that situation, of course, this kind of wailing will harm us. That's why Imam Bukhari, in the Kitab al-Janais, he has a chapter. He said, Bab, Qawlun Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the statement of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, يُعَذِّبُ الْمَيِّتُ بِبَعْدِ بُكَاءِ أَهْلِهِ عَلَيْهِ. A dead person will be punished because of the بِبَعْدِ, for some types of the weeping of his family. The one which is considered as wailing. Then he said, إِذَا كَانَ النَّوْحُ مِن سُنَّتِهِ, if the wailing is part of their sunnah. Imam Bukhari clarifies, not all sorts of wailing, only the wailing which is part of the sunnah. Then he said, لِقَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, for the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ أَهْلِكُمْ نَارَ, save yourself and your family from the hellfire. So Imam Bukhari is saying, if you want to save yourself from the hellfire and your family, you should warn against the wailing. And if you don't warn against the wailing, then wailing is part of your sunnah. So then you will be punished. And upon you will be the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then he said, وَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, and the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, كُلُّكُمْ رَائِنْ وَمَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِي, all of you are shepherds and all of you will be asked about your flocks. Imam al-Bukhari, his fiqh is just magnificent. He's saying that, how do you protect yourself and your family from the hellfire? By taking care of your flock. Warning your family members who you're responsible for. Hey, watch out, don't do this when I die. You, whether you are a male or a female, you have to do that to your family members. فَإِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مِنْ سُنَّتِهِ, and if it is not from his sunnah, فَهُوَ كَمَا قَالَتْ عَائِشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا, it is as Aisha said, لَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةُ وِزْرَ أُخْرَ, a soul will not carry the burden of another soul. وَهُوَ كَقَوْلِهِ, and it is like what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِن تَدْعُ مُثْقَلَةً, if somebody is called to carry their burden, إِلَى حِمْلِهَا, to carry the burden, لَا يَحْمِلُ مِنْهُ شَيْءٍ, they will not carry anything from their burden. One person will not carry the burden of another person. So what Imam al-Bukhari here means that Aisha radiallahu anha, when she gave this interpretation, she is explaining that if it is not part of your sunnah, then inshallah will not be punished because of this kind of wailing. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from this matter of al-jahiliyyah and to make us submit to the tradition of the sunnah or the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illa ant, أستغفرك وأتوب إليك, والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.